Can I ask you about playing Joe Elliott?
Oh, yes, please. Yeah.
Okay. Now that is kind of, that's dangerous territory to get into. Not so much for an artist with confidence, but because of the way people expect the interpretation to go. I mean, the world is full of people who from their couch will tell you a better way to do things. And the thing about portraying Def Leppard or a member of Def Leppard was the group had been through so much yet was so iconic that people felt like they knew them and still feel like they knew them. And here you are, like, they're going to give you like the front man role as Joe Elliott. And I mean, like that, first of all, I'm kind of curious what the audition process was. Now, for those who haven't picked up on it, this guy is a fantastic singer, and we're going to cut to some of his music in a minute. But so you can sing, and that was undoubtedly probably part of it, wouldn't you say?
That's very kind of you to say that. I think it was part of the audition process. When I went for the audition, first of all, I didn't want them to know that I was a kind of, educated middle class boy. I wanted them to think I was from, you know, from the same kind of background as Joe Elliott. So I kind of really took on the voice and the kind of posture. And I looked at a lot of his video of how he had presented, how he was, and tried to sort of bring that into the room. But yeah, part of the audition, I think I did sing a bit. I sang some Led Zeppelin, and I did some kind of crazy moves, you know, because I could see how important that was to doing Joe Elliott, because of how he was able to work these stadiums. So I wanted to go in with that level. And actually part of what I based him on secretly was an actor that I'd worked with at the Royal Shakespeare Company, who was from Sheffield, which was where Joe Elliott was from. And so I tried to bring some of that actor's, you know, power and masculinity and confidence to it, and defiance. So that was, I guess, it was partly thanks to that actor. He doesn't know who it is, but he's there.
And we may not want him to know. I don't know. There's a lot to those things. Let me ask, if I remember the movie right, which it's a great movie to do. It's a great story to tell because it is about sort of overcoming insane obstacles and maintaining, you know, your artistic precision. If I remember right, Anthony Michael Hall played Mutt Lang in that.
Yeah.
Joe,
I want you to go higher right there.
I can't go higher.
Yes, you can.
I can't go higher, all right?
Yes, you can. Just give it a try once more, please.
Taking all the best of me. Oh, can't you see? You got the best of me. Oh, can't you see? You're bringing on the heartbreak.
Stop right there.
What's wrong with it now?
Peace. Hold on one second, okay? Hold on. Okay, play back.
You got the best of me. Whoa, can't you see? You're bringing on the heartbreak. Bringing on the heartbreak.
You're bringing. How did you do that then?
I didn't do anything. You did it.
Nah, you tricked it up.
Listen to me, guys. You got it, okay? Now, you don't know where it is or how to find it or how to polish it once you do find it, but you got it.
And it's been a while since I've seen it. I saw it when it premiered. I haven't had a chance to revisit it. And that's interesting because Mutt Lang is a real character, too, who's sort of instrumental in the band's success, also instrumental in, like, AC/DC's success. And I thought that was interesting that the movie thought enough about the art to kind of work in behind the scenes people as real people and influencers in the situation. But you're doing all this, and as an actor, do you sit back and go, I need to meet the real Joe Elliott? Or do you just go, or do you trust the director and say, how do you want this? Or do you give the director a couple of variations, or is it a mix of all of it? Or how does Orlando go about his day?
Well, you know, it's a really good question. We didn't have that long to prepare for it. You know, I had a, you know, very short time. So what did I do? I watched as much at the time. Obviously, it was before, you know, you could, you know, there wasn't as much access to sort of as things as there are on YouTube now. So it was a much more limited pool of stuff I could see. But I watched everything I could. I listened to everything I could. I did manage to get a phone call with Joe Elliott, thanks to the production company, which was amazing. He was so gracious, so charming, so funny. So that was great. I also actually asked the production company to get a choreographer to come and help, because I really wanted to work with somebody physically to try and find that confidence in the movement and in the sort of the stagecraft. So they were kind enough to help in that way. So, and just even just having the space to try and experiment with that was an important part of it.
Backtrack, if you would, to the phone call with Joe Elliott. Like, you knew that was coming, or was something that caught you by surprise?
I asked for that. Yeah, I definitely asked for that. I would have loved, of course, listen, I would have loved to meet him. But I just, it wasn't possible. We didn't have time. But, you know, he was, but of course, the other thing is that in some ways, I just had to take that leap of faith and say, okay, I'm not actually going to be, I'm not Joe Elliott. I can't be Joe Elliott. I'm just gesturing towards Joe Elliott. I'm giving a kind of, I'm doing enough to hopefully provoke people to dream that maybe this is his story, but the people know it's not him. So it was never, you know, I couldn't hope, I can't suddenly change my face into a completely different shape, you know, and be a different body. And he's bigger than me. And I just had to suggest it, you know, use the viewer's imagination.
Right. Look, actor's interpretation is a big part of this. But, you know, like, as the teacher in the room here, educate us on, you have now a point of reference of who you're playing. So the phone rings, and does Joe Elliott say hello, or does he just go, Joe? I mean, how does it, or does he just expect you to know who it is? Like, it's God. I mean, like, it's me.
He was so nice. He was so unintimidating. He was so friendly and cool, and, you know, I was embarrassed.
Did he have to approve your part? Did he have to approve you to play him, or no?
You know, I don't know about that. Hmm. I don't know.
I may have gone down without even telling you.
I don't know. Yeah, because I what I do know is that I think that, you know, originally he would have quite liked somebody, you know, who was more established and glamorous to have played him, because he was such an extraordinary figure. I mean, you know, I don't have to tell you or your listeners, but, you know, just one of the greatest stars that, you know, in the world for many, many years. And so you know, he you know, he felt that, you know, he should in order to bring that to life, you needed somebody who was of that standing. I wasn't of that standing. So, you know, so in that sense, I think probably it was quite a leap of faith for him to go, well, okay, who's this guy from the Royal Shakespeare Company? Why are we going to let him do it?
No, that's those are credentials, Orlando. That's a credential.
But he, anyway, for whatever reason, they did let me do it. And I was very grateful for that opportunity. And it was, I have to say, it was incredibly fun. Mm-hmm. I mean, incredibly fun, you know, to get to play those songs in, you know, okay, we didn't play full stadiums, but there were quite a lot of extras, quite big sets. And you got to dress up in the crazy costumes, you know, make all the postures, the gestures. It was so much fun. It was just a complete blast. On top of which, being in Montreal, you know, in the spring into the summer, I was very young. You know, it was an amazing experience. We had a really, really lovely crew and director, wonderful cast. It was a blast. It was a real blast. And in fact, I definitely think that was instrumental in reawakening my relationship with music. I'd sung in a band when I was at school. But I hadn't really done any music after leaving school. Maybe I sang in the band at the university for a couple of gigs, but then I'd gotten involved in acting. And so it wasn't really till several years later doing that movie that I suddenly thought, like, no, I've just got to go back to this more. And then it was after that in Los Angeles that I started, right, I'm going to learn the guitar. And I started learning there and listening to all these amazing artists that, you know, they're based in LA, like Elliott Smith, who sadly is no longer here, but just all these just great, great artists playing there at that time, and I started writing my own material. So it's really thanks to that job that I think it did kickstart that in me again.
You know, that's one of the great rewards about our business is what it can inspire. But I love that you're living the dream. Like, you're not only getting paid as an actor, but you're playing the icon rock and roll guy, and you get some of the imaginative, you know, firepower that goes with it. Like, it's almost like you get a chance to look in on what the life may have been like at times.
Yeah.
But what does a guy like you, I'm sorry, go ahead, Owen. I didn't mean to talk over you.
No, please. I mean, God, I'm talking too much. It's just that I suppose also the story is, it just reminds one of how, just how incredibly overpowering that kind of attention and influence is, and how you see it in their story, how it's difficult for any one human to hold that kind of Apollonian godlike power. You know, you have to be a very strong vessel to contain it. So in fact, I would say, you know, respect to Joe and those guys for managing to stay alive.
Yeah.
With holding that much focus and power, and it's traveling through you in that way.
Well, tragically, not all of them did, unfortunately. I mean, look, it's a business full of landmines and demons, and you've got to be a sharpshooter to get through it. I mean, that's the side of the business that a lot of people don't talk about, is the navigational side.
They were known as Lucifer and the Men with Painted Faces. Then they burned New Orleans to the ground. And when they sacked Panama, I knew that my road to redemption would be paved with tombstones. And by the time they brought the apocalypse to West Africa, and the Indian Ocean, I would come to know two words with biblical significance. No quarter. No quarter. Kill All Masters. Rated R. Coming soon. Available on all platforms. Visit noquarterkillallmasters.com.